A Christmas Carol by Charles Dickens. This abridged version is from the Hindley Reading Library Illustrated Classics Collection. Read for you today by Melissa Abrams. A Christmas Carol, Stave 5, Chapter 7, Christmas Day. Yes! Only the bedpost was there. Scrooge's own bedpost in his own room. Best of all, the time was his own. Time for Scrooge to make amends. "I will live in the past, the present, and the future," vowed Scrooge. And he repeated those words over and over as he happily scrambled out of bed. "Oh, Jacob Marley! Oh, heaven and Christmas time! Praised be to you all for this, for my second chance. I say it on my knees, old Jacob, on my knees." Scrooge was sobbing now, but glowing happily in his sobbing. His face was wet with tears. "They are not torn down," he cried, folding one of the bed curtains in his arms. "They are not torn down, rings and all. They are here. I am here. The shadows of things to come may still be changed. They will be. I know they will." Scrooge's hands were busy with his clothes as he rushed to get dressed. In his joyous excitement, he was turning his clothes inside out, putting them on upside down, tearing them, dropping them. "I don't know what to do," he cried, laughing and crying in the same breath. "I am as light as a feather. I am as happy as an angel. I am as merry as a schoolboy. I am as giddy as a drunken man. A Merry Christmas to everybody. A Happy New Year to all the world. Hello, whoopee!" Scrooge had skipped into his sitting room and was now standing there out of breath. "There's my saucepan of broth still on the fireplace ledge," he cried, skipping around again, overjoyed to see things as they were. "There's the door by which the ghost of Jacob Marley entered. There's the corner where the ghost of Christmas Present sat. There's the window through which I saw the wandering, crying spirits. It's all true. It all happened. Ha ha ha!" For a man who had not had so much practice laughing for so many years, Scrooge's laugh was a splendid one, a brilliant one. "I don't know what day of the month it is," he said. "I don't know how long I have been among the spirits. I don't know anything. I'm a baby. Never mind. I don't care. I'd rather be a baby. Hello, whoopee!" Scrooge was stopped for a moment in his bounding leaps by the church bells ringing out the loudest, happiest peals he had ever heard. "Ding, dong, bell!" Scrooge repeated with them in chorus. "Bell, dong, ding, clang, clash, oh, glorious bells!" Then, running to the window, Scrooge opened it and stuck his head out. "The fog is gone," he said happily. "The mist is gone. It is a clear, bright, happy, cold day, cold enough to make my blood dance and dance gaily. Oh, golden sunlight, how you are shining! Oh, heavenly sky! Oh, sweet, fresh air! Oh, merry bells! Oh, glorious, glorious life!" Then, seeing a boy below dressed in Sunday clothes, Scrooge called down, "Tell me, lad, what day is today?" "Huh?" answered the boy in surprise. "What day is today, my fine fellow?" repeated Scrooge. "Today?" replied the boy. "Why, it's Christmas Day!" "It's Christmas Day!" whispered Scrooge joyously. "I haven't missed it after all. The spirits did it all in one night. They can do anything they like. Of course they can." Then Scrooge leaned out the window again, calling, "Hello there, my fine fellow! Do you know the poultry shop at the corner of the next street?" "Yes, sir, of course," answered the boy. "An intelligent lad," said Scrooge, smiling. "In fact, a remarkable boy. Tell me, lad, do you know if they've sold the prize turkey that's been hanging up in the window? Not the little one, the big one. You mean the one as big as me? Asked the boy. What a delightful boy, exclaimed Scrooge. What a pleasure to talk to him. Yes, my lad, that's the one I mean. It's hanging there now, sir, answered the boy. Good, cried Scrooge. Go and buy it. You're joking, exclaimed the boy. No, no, said Scrooge. I am serious. Go and buy it and tell him to bring it here. I'll give him directions where to take it. Go now, boy, and come back with the poultry man, and I'll give you a shilling for your trouble. In fact, lad, if you come back with him in less than 5 minutes, I'll give you half a crown. The boy took off like a shot. I'll send it to Bob Cratchit's, whispered Scrooge, rubbing his hands in anticipation and splitting his sides with laughter. And he shan't know who sent it. Why, that turkey's twice the size of Tiny Tim. What a fine joke this will be. Scrooge set about writing the Cratchit's address on a piece of paper. His hand was not very steady after all he had been through, but write it he did. Then he rushed downstairs and to the door to wait for the poultry man. As Scrooge stood there waiting for him to arrive, the large door knocker caught his eye. I shall love you as long as I live, he cried, patting the knocker lovingly. I hardly ever looked at you before, knocker. What an honest expression you have on your face. You're a wonderful knocker. Oh, here's the turkey. Hello! How are you? Merry Christmas! And what a turkey it was! Scrooge couldn't see how the bird ever could have stood on its legs, for its body was so huge. Why, it's impossible to carry that turkey all the way to that part of town where the Cratchits live, Scrooge told the poultry man. You must take a cab. Scrooge chuckled as he said this, and chuckled as he paid for the turkey, and chuckled when he paid for the cab, and chuckled when he tipped the boy. But the loudest chuckle came when he sat down breathless in his chair and chuckled till he cried. Shaving was next. Not an easy task for Scrooge, as his hand continued to shake, since he was dancing as he was doing it. But if he had cut off the end of his nose, he would have put a piece of bandage over it and quite forgotten about it. He dressed himself in his best clothes and went down into the street. By now, people were walking about, as he had seen them do with the Ghost of Christmas Present. Walking with his hands behind him, Scrooge looked at everyone with a delighted smile. He looked so pleasant, in fact, that three or four jovial men said, "Good morning, sir! A Merry Christmas to you!" Scrooge was to say later that of all the happy sounds he had ever heard, those were the happiest to his ears. He had not gone far when he saw approaching him the stout gentleman who, with his associate, had visited his warehouse yesterday to request a donation for charity. Oh dear, thought Scrooge, what must that old gentleman think of me? I must change that opinion immediately. So Scrooge quickened his steps until he was face to face with the man. My dear sir, he said, taking the startled gentleman by both hands. How do you do? I hope you were successful yesterday. I hope you collected much money for the poor. It was so kind of you to give your time for this noble effort. A Merry Christmas to you, sir. Mr. Scrooge? Asked the man, bewildered. Are you the same Mr. Scrooge I called on yesterday? Yes, answered Scrooge. That is my name, although I fear you might not think too highly of it. Please let me ask your pardon, and will you accept? And Scrooge whispered in the old gentleman's ear. Lord bless me! Cried the gentleman as he gasped for breath. My dear Mr. Scrooge, are you serious? Yes, said Scrooge, and not a shilling less. This includes a great many back payments that I missed. Now, will you accept it? "My dear sir," said the gentleman, shaking hands with Scrooge, "I don't know what to say to such generosity. Why, I..."
"Don't say anything, please," interrupted Scrooge. "Just come and see me from time to time when you are nearby, will you?"
"I will," cried the old gentleman, and he really meant it.
"Thank you," said Scrooge, "and God bless you."
Scrooge spent the rest of that Christmas morning in a most remarkable way, a way he had never done before. He went to church, then walked about the streets. He watched people hurrying to and fro. He patted children on the head. He talked to beggars. He looked into windows of houses and took pleasure in seeing happy people enjoying the holiday. Everything he did, everything he saw gave him pleasure. He had never dreamed that any walk, that anything, could bring him so much happiness. In the afternoon, Scrooge turned his steps to his nephew's house. But when he reached the door, he walked past it a dozen times before he got up the courage to knock. Finally, he made a dash to the door and knocked. A smiling young housemaid answered the door.
"Is your master at home, my dear?" asked Scrooge.
"Yes, sir."
"Where is he, my dear?"
"In the dining room, sir, along with the mistress. I'll show you in and announce you, sir."
"Thank you," said Scrooge, with his hand already on the dining room doorknob. "He knows me. I'll go right in."
Scrooge turned the knob gently and peeked his face around the slightly open door. His niece and nephew were standing admiring their beautifully set holiday dinner table, making certain that everything was ready for their guests when they arrived.
"Fred!" called Scrooge.
"Why, bless my soul!" cried Fred. "Who is it?"
"It is I, your Uncle Scrooge. I have come to dinner. Will you let me in?"
"Let you in?" cried Fred, rushing up to Scrooge and shaking his hand so hard and so long that it seemed to Scrooge his hand might fall off. It took no more than 5 minutes, and Uncle Scrooge was feeling right at home. Nothing could have made him happier. Then the guests came, all those guests Scrooge had seen when he was with the Ghost of Christmas Present, and they all looked the same as they did in the spirit's shadows. It was a wonderful party, with all the music and all the games Scrooge had only been able to hear and watch earlier. Now he was part of them, part of the wonderful friendly spirit, part of the wonderful gaiety, part of the wonderful happiness. Chapter 8, A New Boss for Bob. Early the next morning, Scrooge arrived at his office early. He had his heart set on being there especially early, and even catching Bob Cratchit coming in late. And he did. Yes, he did. The clock struck 9. No Bob. 9:15. No Bob. "He's now 18 and a half minutes late," said Scrooge with a grin as he sat at his desk with the door open so he could watch for this clerk. Suddenly, the outer door burst open, and in one movement, Bob Cratchit removed his hat and scarf and was on his stool, pen in hand.
"Hello," growled Scrooge, trying hard to use his former harsh voice. "What do you mean by strolling in here at this hour of the day?"
"I'm very sorry, sir," said Bob, as his pen was speedily scratching away. "I know I'm late."
"Yes, I think you are," said Scrooge. "Come into my office immediately."
It only happened once, sir," pleaded Bob as he appeared at the door to Scrooge's office. "It won't happen again, sir, I promise. It was only because of the holiday celebration yesterday, sir."
"I'm not going to stand for this sort of thing any longer," growled Scrooge as he leaped down from his stool with his ruler in his hand and came face to face with Cratchit. "And so," added Scrooge, pounding his ruler into the young man's chest and forcing him to back out of the office, "so I'm going to raise your salary."
Bob trembled and took a few timid steps toward the ruler. He had the momentary idea of grabbing that ruler and knocking Scrooge down with it and holding the old man on the floor while he called for the police to bring a straitjacket, for surely Scrooge had lost his mind. "A Merry Christmas, Bob," said Scrooge, and his voice was so sincere that Bob could no longer doubt that the old man really meant what he said. Bob smiled, but still could not speak as Scrooge slapped him on the back and repeated his Christmas wishes. "A merrier Christmas, my good fellow, than I have ever given you in many years," said Scrooge, smiling. "Not only am I raising your salary, but I'm going to try to help your struggling family, too." Bob still stood frozen in amazement and could only nod and smile. "Yes, Bob," continued Scrooge, "we will discuss all these things this very afternoon over a Christmas drink of hot port wine. We'll talk about an apprenticeship for Master Peter and see what doctors we can find to help Tiny Tim. We'll scour the entire world if we have to, but we'll find someone who can do something for that angel of a boy."
"Yes, sir," exclaimed Bob, sobbing. "Thank you, sir. Thank you, sir."
"And Bob," added Scrooge, "let's raise the fire and get more heat in here. In fact, hurry out right now and buy another coal bucket to keep in your office, and lots more coal as well. And do it before you dot another I with your pen, Bob Cratchit." Chapter 9, The New Ebenezer Scrooge. Scrooge kept his word. He did everything he promised and more, much more. To Tiny Tim, who did not die and who even walked again without his crutches, Scrooge became a second father. He became as good a friend, as good a boss, and as good a citizen as the old city or any other city in the world had ever known. Some people laughed to see the change in him, but Scrooge let them laugh, for he knew that nothing good ever happened in this world that some people did not laugh at first. What was more important to Scrooge was that his own heart was laughing with joy at giving and helping others. Ebenezer Scrooge had no further meetings with the spirits, but still he continued to live a good life. People soon began to say of him that he truly knew the meaning of the spirit of Christmas, perhaps better than any man alive. And he lived with that spirit not only at Christmas time, but all during the year. And Ebenezer Scrooge's words for the rest of his long and happy life were Tiny Tim's words, "God bless us, everyone."